German Nazi. There it is. So does that tell you anything about the, yeah, does that tell you anything about the church, the Christian church in America? Yes. Is there a message here?
Yes.
So the Catholic Church and all the other churches, all of them together, are referred to in the Bible as the Whore of Babylon. These people are nothing but a bunch of whores. And they're doing business with anybody and anything. It's all business. You kill, rape, murder. It's just business. Nothing personal. All the conspiracy against the human race is made possible by our fascist press, newspapers, magazines, the fascist press. So I guess that's it. I would just, yeah, thank you. So I suppose the bottom line on all of this is quite simply, I would suggest that each one of you begin to re-look at spirituality from a different point of view. And just understand that synagogues, churches, mosques, the religious institutions in America and in the Western world, as probably for the whole world, actually, but I'm more concerned about my own country, has nothing of any value in churches, synagogues, period. There's nothing of any value in any of them. They're all man-made corporations. They've all played the whore with the church, with government, with the religio, political, military, industrial complex. It's one big, huge whorehouse of money, corruption, and politics. And I believe that there is a profound presence in the world that we call God, whatever God is. But I am totally sure that God, there is one. And whatever there is it's going to deal with the human race. And people know that there's some serious problems coming, but they have no idea in the world how serious it's really going to be. Because when you get these kind of people running the U.S. government and running governments around the world that don't mind sawing children's heads off and killing you and throwing you into prison, when you have no laws to protect you, we as human beings on this earth are in serious trouble. You have no idea in the world how serious this trouble that's coming really is. So the only thing I would suggest that I know works, and this is very, very important, and I think you should listen to this and try it. Just understand that you are a biological battery. You are a biological electrical unit, like a radio or television, and you can receive waves from somewhere else. You can receive spiritual knowledge. I would suggest each one of you find a place where there's nobody around and sit and talk audibly with the spirit world. It's called prayer, but I'm not talking about the nonsense that these people are pushing for prayer, because there's a very big difference in I should explain to you this. Faith, the very word faith, is misunderstood in the Christian and Western world. Faith is not what you think it is. The very word faith is a word that means, and the only way I can describe it, is that when you get up in the morning, you put your feet on the floor and you didn't look on the floor to see if there was a floor there. But you just got up and put your feet on the floor, not even thinking about it. Why didn't you check to see if there was a floor there? It just has always been there. Obviously, it's there, and so why would you make a big to-do over looking for a floor if you know it's there? That's what faith is. That's what faith means. To do something and just assume that God will be there. And every time, it is there. The divine spirit in the universe is always there. It's just you that's been out. But the divine spirit is always there. And so seek and you will find. Ask and you will receive. You have not, the Bible has the Jesus saying, you have not because you ask not. And the whole world is looking for spirituality. It's right there in you. All you got to do is talk to the Spirit. So just find a place quiet and sit down and talk audibly. It has to be audible. The spirit world has to hear you. Something about that, I don't know how it works, but the spirit world, or whatever you want to call God, wants to hear it. So you talk audibly to the Spirit and ask the Spirit to protect you, to guide you, to make sure you meet the right person, to make sure you hear the right thing, make sure you don't get in trouble, and show me what I'm supposed to do, protect me. Whatever is to happen in the city, protect me, show me what I have to do, show me what I'm supposed to learn, and I will do it, and protect me. Talk. Because what you don't know is there is an intelligence watching you right now. You just didn't know it. I mean, we know that the government's watching us, and they're very silent. God is watching you, too. The Spirit of God is watching each one of us. You just didn't know it. And it's watching to see what you're going to do with your life. And it's kind of like it doesn't intervene necessarily in your life. Just watch what that person's doing. And if they don't want spiritual direction and protection, well, you have not because you ask not. Ask and you will receive. So I would suggest that each one of you talk to the Spirit, ask the Spirit to protect you, to guide you, to make sure you learn what you're supposed to learn, know what you're supposed to know. And then, most important, ask the Spirit to show me that you are hearing me. Give me a sign that you're hearing me and I'm not talking to myself. So show me a sign that you're hearing, that you're here with me and you're hearing me. Show me something so I will know that you're hearing me. Watch what happens. Because if scary things start happening around you, you wake up at 2:00 in the morning and there's some kind of a glowing figure there by your bed, or something like that happens to you, and it scares the pee wads out of you. Well, you did ask, didn't you? You said, show me. And I'm telling you, the Spirit will do something to get your attention, and it will be scary. But it will be the first time that you will actually know that there is a spirit world watching you. Because you said, show me that you're here. They will. You ask, you will receive. But then when that happens, don't be afraid, because actually you're the one that asked to be shown. And they will begin to guide you, and you all of a sudden will meet the right person. You will find the things that you really need will just pop in on you out of nowhere. And all of a sudden your life will start smoothing out. And because why? Because for the first time, you're not being arrogant, self-centered, egotistical, know-it-all, but be humble and ask the Spirit, show me what I'm supposed to do, and I'll do it. Protect me and show me where I'm supposed to meet, who I'm supposed to meet, what I'm supposed to learn. Show me and I will do it. And then show me that you're hearing me and watch what happens. That's spirituality. This is corporate government. Thank you.
Something amazing, tragic, and of importance happened to me. I awakened, I shattered my mind of understanding in 1,000 pieces and became utterly lost in what was real, what was false, how to perceive whether someone is truthful, whether someone is deceitful, and most importantly, I had lost all understanding of myself and my purpose of existence. I was dead to the world and dead to myself. I ended up this way through a combination of life experiences, indoctrination, and a continuous ongoing determent to my mind and my own existence. Literally, a place of hell where I was unable to escape, no matter what I did. Finally, there was a breaking point and I couldn't take it anymore. It was bad enough that I was in a place where I just wanted everything to end and die, but what came, came anyway. An event, that in the case of a world of all of a world of righteousness, good, and truth, should have never been placed upon me. It was a WTF unexpected event in my life that came without reason or explanation. I had no answers on how, and why. Looking back, it was something that had been the final straw, something that kickstarted a flight of fight response in an outcome that would either make or break my very existence. I chose to fight. And the only way to start that fight for I was to first figure out the how and why it happened. So I started seeking, I searched, I kept at it, seeking and seeking and seeking for understanding of this painful reality. Then it came, a small glimpse of the why and a huge understanding of the how. It was a lot of work, but finally, I knew somewhat how the world actually was working and why it was working and in an existence as such it did. But all this work, all this understanding didn't one bit help my state of being. In fact, it made things worse when I realized the total chaos, illusion, deception, and just pure evil world we all lived in. It was especially hard to take history and all the realization of the millions who suffered, killed, and for the only purpose of benefiting the few at the expense of others. I then felt hopeless and trapped back into my hellish existence, but now too I had the burden and the pain of knowing the truth of it all. At that point, I totally shattered and cried for hours. Like I had just taken on all the pain and suffering of the world. I was totally shattered, or so I thought. It was then, there was one thing I did have of self, and it was my heart. It was empathy for others. Then something sparked in myself and a fire was started from within to fight again. The fight wasn't for me this time. I still remained broken and could at that point care less about myself. This time, the fight was to help others who had no idea what was coming or what evils has transgressed throughout past history. Somehow I came to the realization that this fight was good versus evil, God versus Satan, truth versus illusion, type of fight. I realized that if I had any chance to gain ground in this war, I would have to know now how, why, and understand the spiritual realm. This is where I envisioned all the evil existed and that all the good in this world must have started. But there I was again, not knowing how and why. I had never been to church, read one line of the Bible, or had any spiritual teachings ever. But my mind was a clean slate, ready to seek the truth and understanding as I has been able to overcome for the physical world. So again, I started seeking and seeking. But this time I knew the illusion of the physical world and trusted nothing without proof. My days of just believing what I was told were over. I took nothing for granted and believed nothing strongly without reinforcement, my inner gut feeling, and experience, seeing is believing. I feel now that I was lucky to never embark and be indoctrinated through the various religions that have all developed over time. I felt I could study all of them and then pick a path teaching after I had weeded out all what I thought I could figure out where the false doctrines were. But unfortunately, I came to the realization I could study for thousands of years and never figure out for sure what true and what was not true. All of it, that I could see at the time, was based on history of someone else's experiences and their testimony of such. And since the word of these people had existed before I, and the only way I felt I could get to a place of understanding was with the correct doctrine, I found my path to know truth was blocked. At that point I gave up, frustrated and again stuck, blocked, and left without a life's purpose to do what I thought was righteous and for God's cause. But then it came to me. The only way of knowing was if God was to show me himself. And if it was that important for me to know and live through his understanding, he would just have to show me or tell me in some way. Basically, I had left the ball in his court. But one more thing came to me, the scripture, ask and receive. So the words came, straight from my heart within. A pleading and a passion like no other I had ever presented. A righteous pledge to help God in his battle, if only he showed me how. If only he showed me what to learn, only if he proved to me it was truth. I left things there and stopped my journey. If God, Jesus, the Creator, countersource of whatever was in charge of what was good wanted my unconditional pledge to learn truth, led in truth, and spread truth in love and wisdom, that proof would come. 2 days later, it all started to come in little pieces, like puzzle pieces of synchronicities and rare coincidences that when all put together told me my answer as plain as day and with no doubt, since the chances of all that had happened and managed to fit as my answer was so mathematically impossible, it had to be of divine influence. And since that help had never stopped since that day. and since that guidance of light of understanding always leads to truth of righteousness, love, and understanding that always destroys the existence of a deception, lie, or illusion, I feel assured that it is guidance, wisdom, and knowledge of truth from the correct source. That experience of seeing divinity reinforces the knowing of the truth, rather than the believing of the truth. Knowing is the key, that makes truth all-powerful and everlasting. Believing, without proof and experience, is in the end still just a best guess of what the truth is. Without knowing, there is still doubt, and lessens the power of truth to shine the light of understand upon the false and completely destroying its existence. And so the same in reverse, if all truth is replaced by what is false, truth is lost, still existing, but unknown, and never to be realized again, leaving it in a lost, never to be found state of existence. Which leaves the false completely encompassing the self in a state of darkness and leaving one to never escape it. To me, this is why there is so much chaos, distraction, and leading astray from truth. And the only way to eliminate or stop the progression of that dark state into keep knowledge, understanding, and shine that light of truth to will the battle of truth, love, and light, the will and wish of God the Creator. All that, what I just babbled on about. Where did I learn it? Where did I read it? Who told me that teaching? Nobody did. Why then are those beliefs firmly embedded as my reality after my experience? It's my strong belief that we all have the knowledge of truth within and we just need to seek it and know it as the light of understanding. That all knowledge and what we need is all right within us. That most are lost in illusion and fail to recognize this. That truth is always known but sometimes unrealized until the realization of one's own experience of proof. This why people say, know they self. And the only way to do so, is to seek it out, realize it, and know it. Finally, I believe if one has a strong enough passion for the knowing, wanting, and having truth, God's reality, the Holy Spirit will lead the way after asking. Anyway, I wanted to tell you all this, because like you, I have passion to help others realize this reality, and as you preach your wisdom and understanding to me, I want to do the same for you.
V14-21. 1. Jesus was aware of doubts within the minds of the apostles, but the doubts did not concern him. 2. Jesus' vision of the face of Christ was nearing its fullness, and his heart was filled with love and peace at all times. 3. Yet, he knew the apostles' doubts concerned them. 4. For in their minds, they had given up much to follow Jesus. 5. They sought fullness in faith that their choice had been the right one, so their doubts concerned them gravely. 6. One night, Jesus spoke to the apostles about their doubt. 7. He explained that like the Pharisees who had questioned him, doubt could blind them to the reflection of light within their minds. 8. But he also explained that their doubts did not take the light away. 9. The light is always within you, Jesus explained. 10. And like yeast that has been placed in flour, this light expands within your mind, even now, as you doubt. 11. Those the Father has called to do his service will follow their call. 12. For they can do nothing else. 13. The desire is strong within them or they would not have heard the call. 14. Let your doubts not concern you. 15. They are merely fear, and fear is nothing, so it cannot hold you back. 16. Look at your doubts and lay them aside, that you may continue the work your Father has called you to do. V22-26. 1. Everywhere Jesus went, he helped people to see differently. 2. As he taught with joy, touching many people, the apostles began to see differently too. 3. More and more, the apostles began to seek private counsel with Jesus to discuss their fears and doubts. 4. Jesus responded lovingly with every discussion that was brought to him. 5. Never did the apostles feel judged. 6. Increasingly, they became aware of a new sight, a way of seeing the world that they hadn't known before. 7. As this new sight filled their hearts with joy, they became increasingly committed to doing the work of their Father. 91 V 27-30. 1. And so the time came that Jesus again talked to the apostles about their doubts. 2. Who do people say I am? Jesus asked. 3. The apostles answered with rumors they had heard while teaching. 4. There were many perspectives among the people, but no one seemed to know the truth. 5. And who do you say I am? Asked Jesus. 6. A great teacher, answered Thomas quickly. 7. A master in the service of our Lord. 8. Peter, Jesus asked. 9. And you? 10. Who do you say I am, Peter? 11. Peter was quiet for a moment before answering, reflecting upon the answer that had been given him in his mind. 12. You are me, Master, the Son of God the Christ. 13. You are one who has learned this awareness, and so you share it with us, as Thomas has pointed out. 14 Jesus smiled. 15 This you did not learn from men, Peter. 16 This you learned from the voice of our Lord within. 17 In trusting this voice, you have shared a great truth. 18 Jesus spoke to all of the apostles. 19 The voice within will lead you clearly when you give it your trust and put your doubts aside. 20 It will reveal truths to you that you have not imagined, and so you will know they are true. 21 And even as this voice speaks, you may hear another voice that brings doubt and fear. 22 Place that voice aside, for the voice of fear will cloud the vision of light and hide that light from you. 23 But when the voice of fear is let go, the light will shine to place heaven within your sight. 24 I truly say to you, watch the thoughts within your mind. 25 Choose what you will believe carefully. 26 For what you believe in heaven, although it may hide heaven from your sight. 27 The apostles understood Jesus' words, although they did not all believe them. V 31-38. 1 Then Jesus talked to the apostles about transcendence. 2 He talked of transcending fear and doubt, and he talked to them about.
I've been doing this research for you folks that don't know anything about me. I've been a researcher and litigator and historian of sorts for going on, gosh, now it's over 38 years. Now it started on 39, or it will shortly on the 17th. I'm sorry, I'm getting a little ahead of myself here by one day. My quest began September the 17th because of prison doors slamming behind me a long time ago for a crime that I hadn't committed involving some construction work here on Pennsylvania. And the quest was to figure out how that could happen, how you could be convicted in a court of justice for a crime that you not only didn't commit, but it never took place. 1994, after many 20-some years of litigating in the barfly courts, becoming pretty proficient at doing that and such things, I was introduced to common law and had come to the realization, and most of you folks won't agree with me, and that's fine, that there are no constitutions, that lawful government ended with the Continental Congress retiring. And government that I had been raised under and educated under was all fraud. In 1994, I lost a family farm, and I was sitting on the back steps of the back stoop of the farmhouse about 6-7 o'clock in the evening, knowing that they were coming next morning to evict Mom and I off of the land, contemplating whether I was going to send Mom to stay with relatives and go to war with these people and shoot it out, or what to do, and frankly bawling like a baby and feeling pretty hopeless. And I'm sure a lot of you have felt this way, losing your homes and freedoms and things like that, and your families being split up and children taken away. So I have a sense of what some of you are going through. But started praying, and I made a an accord with God that if He would give me the knowledge and discernment to understand what was going on with this system I was battling, trying to find justice, that I would serve Him and so that's kind of where the quest began, to figure this system out and what it's made of and how it functions and how it does what it does to us as people, and we just have no clue as to what it is and how it's operating
It Works by R.H.J. The famous little red book that makes your dreams come true. A clear, definite, common-sense plan of accomplishment. Originally published in 1926, this book, with its valuable message, is presented to you by the Master Key Society. Copyright 2021, Master Key Society, read by Randy Scott. You have within you a mighty power, anxious and willing to serve you. A power capable of giving you that which you earnestly desire. This power is described by Thompson J. Hudson, Ph.D., LL.D., author of The Law of Psychic Phenomena as Your Subjective Mind. Other learned writers use different names and terms, but all agree that it is omnipotent. Therefore, I call this power Immanuel, God in us. Regardless of the name of the great power, or the conscious admission of a God, the power is capable and willing to carry to a complete and perfect conclusion very earnest desire of your objective mind. But you must be really in earnest about what you want. Occasional wishing or half-hearted wanting does not form a perfect connection or communication with your omnipotent power. You must be in earnest, sincerely and truthfully desiring certain conditions or things, mental, physical, or spiritual. Your objective mind and will are so vacillating that you usually only wish for things and the wonderful. Capable power within you does not function. Most wishes are simply vocal expressions. Jimmy, the office boy, gave no thought of possessing the red roadster. Landham, the salesman, was not thinking of any other job or even thinking at all. President Bondum knew he had hay fever and was expecting it. Father's business was quite likely successful, and Mother no doubt brought home first prize from the bridge party that day. But they had no fixed idea of what they really wanted their children to accomplish and were actually helping to bring about the unhappy conditions which existed. If you are in earnest about changing your present condition, here is a concise, definite, resultful plan with rules, explanations, and suggestions. The plan. Write down on paper, in order of their importance, the things and conditions you really want. Do not be afraid of wanting too much. Go the limit in writing down your wants. Change the list daily, adding to or taking from it, until you have it about right. Do not be discouraged on account of changes, as this is natural. There will always be changes and additions with accomplishments and increasing desires. Three positive rules of accomplishment. 1. Read the list of what you want 3 times each day, morning, noon, and night. 2. Think of what you want as often as possible. 3. Do not talk to anyone about your plan except to the great power within you, which will unfold to your objective mind the method of accomplishment. It is obvious that you cannot acquire faith at the start. Some of your desires, from all practical reasoning, may seem positively unattainable, but nevertheless, write them down in your list in the proper place of importance to you. There is no need to analyze how this power within you is going to accomplish your desires. Such a procedure is as unnecessary as trying to figure out why a grain of corn placed in fertile soil shoots up a green stalk, blossoms, and produces an ear of corn containing hundreds of grains, each capable of doing what the one grain did. if you will follow this definite plan and carry out the three simple rules, the method of accomplishment will unfold quite as mysteriously as the ear of corn appears on the stalk, and in most cases, much sooner than you expect.
What do you want to do tonight?
Same thing we do every night, Pinky. Try to take over the world.
He said these words, chapter 12, the very end of it. It's called The Veil Removed. This is the ineffable secret, the ultimate illumination, the key to peace and power. You are God. Those are the three magic words. If you will accept this towering truth and dare to stand atop this magnificent pinnacle, universal consciousness will be revealed to you from within. God is there. It is He who peers from behind your eyes, who is your own consciousness, who is your very self. You are not just a part of God, you are altogether God. And God is altogether you. Now, that's scary stuff for a lot of people. We weren't raised to believe that. I'm not saying that you ought to go out into the world and say, excuse me, but you know who you're talking to, that I am God. And the reason that we laugh is because we think of God as the God that we've created in our own image, the God of the ego, the God who's angry, the God who wants special favors, the God who has the ability to heal but withholds it. But there's another word that Jesus used in the New Testament, and this is the God I speak of, quoting him. God is love. And he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in me, and I in him. God is love, pure, unconditional, blissful, divine love. That's who you are. The second great teaching was a man named Neville Goddard, passed away in 1972, lectured over in California, particularly in the 40s and 50s and 60s. I read his book, The Power of Awareness, 7 times. I gave it to each one of my children at Christmas a couple of years ago, and they called me up and they said, Dad, it's great, but I don't understand it. It's a little heavy. I said, well, then maybe it's part of my Dharma to make it a little clearer. And chapter 27, the last chapter of his book, The Power of Awareness, it says this. In all of creation, in all of eternity, in all the realms of your infinite being, the most wonderful fact is that which is stressed in the first chapter of this book. You are God. You are the I am that I am. You are consciousness. You are the creator. This is the mystery. This is the great secret known by the seers and prophets and mystics throughout the ages. This is the truth that you can never know intellectually. If you want to understand something intellectually, what you must do is analyze it, come up with a formula for it, study it, look at other experts about it, and come up to a conclusion. If you want to understand something spiritually, you must first experience it. You must come to know this within. In the New Testament, which I read completely before I wrote Wishes Fulfilled, Jesus is about to be stoned. And he says, why would you stone me? And they say, because you blaspheme. You are a man, and you claim to be God. And Jesus responds in his words, is it not written in your laws that I have said you are gods? All of you. We are all gods. We have within us not the God that so often we are taught is outside of us, but the God that is love, the God that is perfect love. The soul that wants to expand because it is infinite and doesn't want to be restricted. And I came across some great teachings that were sent to me. They showed up, as we often think, they show up as accidents, but you come to realize that there are no accidents in this universe. Everything that takes place is have the pieces moved around by something bigger than all of us. And so it was called the I Am Discourses. And I quote from the I Am Discourses. The first expression of every individual everywhere in the universe, either in spoken word, silent thought, or feeling, is I Am, recognizing its own conquering divinity. The student, me, you, all of us, endeavoring to understand and apply these mighty yet simple laws must stand guard more strictly over his thoughts and expression in words or otherwise. For every time you say, I am not, I cannot, I have not, you are, whether knowingly or unknowingly, throttling that great presence within you. These words, I am. I opened up this program with the words, I am well. I am perfect health. And where do you think they came from? What do these words I am mean? A very quick retracing of the story of Moses. Moses, this little baby who was born at a time when the Pharaoh had ordered all male children to be drowned in the Nile, and Moses' mother took his little baby, put him in a basket and floated him down the Nile. Moses was discovered by the Pharaoh's daughter. The Pharaoh's daughter raised Moses as her own son and the Pharaoh's grandson. But along in his late teen years, he got into a conflict and ended up seeing one of the Israelite slaves being mistreated, and he ended up killing him. So Moses had to take off because he was afraid for his own life. And he went out into the Sinai and there married Zipporah and had children and was out as a shepherd. And as the Torah tells us, as it says in Exodus, he comes across a burning bush one day that is not being consumed. And the bush speaks to him. And rather than even misquote this even a little, I brought from my hotel room you wouldn't steal the Bible, would you, Wayne? No, I'll put it back. So the bush speaks in Exodus chapter 3 and says, Moses, Moses. And the first words that Moses says to God are, here I am. Then he said, do not draw near here, this place. Take off your sandals and your feet, for this place where you stand is holy ground. And God speaks to Moses and says, I want you to go to the Pharaoh and I want you to free your people. And Moses is going, whoa, wait, hold on here. Who am I? And who are you? Moses says to God, who am I that I should go to the Pharaoh and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? So he said, I will certainly be with you, and this shall be a sign to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Then Moses says to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel, and I say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? And God says to Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial to all generations. My name is I am that I am. Now, every single time that you use the words I am, you are citing the name of God right from the holiest books. And every time you say the words, I am weak, I am poor, I am unlucky, I am unhappy, I am sick, I am unable to attract into my life what you want, you are desecrating the name of God. God did not say, I will be. My name is, I hope things work out well. My name.
My name is Maybe Things Will Show Up That I Wanted But Possibly Not. He said, I am that I am. You must be conscious of how you use these words, I am. I am strong. I am well. I am content. Even if your senses tell you something different, I am. And as we move now into the meat of this program, you'll see that putting the words I am in front of something into your mind and imagination is a very powerful way to attract into your life, recognizing your own divinity. I am God is not blasphemy. It is your identity.
Down the path, we have chosen.